High school graduation is a meaningful and memorable event. The 2012 graduation ceremony at Miami Lakes Educational Center was very remarkable because of one of the particular members of the graduation class, 92-year-old Julius Eisenstein. Julius never had the opportunity to complete high school in his youth. He was forced into a Nazi concentration camp and then a death camp in Poland prior to the outbreak of World War II. He is a Holocaust survivor. In 2009, Julius and one of his liberators, George Katzman, United States Army retired, came to our school to share their experiences with our students. Julius returned every year for several more years to be a mentor, a teacher to our students. He spoke to a capacity auditorium each time to help the students grasp what had happened 65 years earlier and learn what cruelty and hatred could do. The students petitioned the school board to award Julius a high school diploma, as he essentially had become one of their most beloved teachers. This is their recollection of events leading to the liberation of Dachau, the concentration camp, in Germany on April 29, 1945, as presented to our students.
The first gentleman, his name is George Katzman. You see, George Katzman, hold your applause for a second. George Katzman was a private first class during World War II. He was with the U.S. Armed Forces, who liberated and brought freedom and end to injustice in Europe, and in the process saved all of us. George Katzman liberated the concentration camp of Dachau. In Dachau, we came across somebody who had been robbed of his humanity, of his dignity, somebody who had watched his family perish in a concentration camp of Auschwitz and Dachau, where he was ultimately liberated. Somebody who was born in Poland and lived in Poland with a nurturing family as yours, with the same aspirations and dreams as your parents have for you. And then those dreams were robbed. And he was interned not only in one but two different concentration camps. He was enslaved. He became a bricklayer, a shoemaker, a ditch digger. He did everything he could to stay alive. And alive he stayed, and alive he is, because you can break somebody's bones, but you cannot break the human heart and the human spirit. That man is Julius Eisenstein. Mr. Julius Eisenstein is today 92 years young. Mr. George Katzman is 94 years young today. They are both here today with their spouses, the liberator and the liberated. Two souls joined in history. I am going to use the privilege of the mic and the podium to ask, not only first so you see him proudly still wearing, and it fits elegantly and beautifully with all of the dignity that that uniform represents. Please first, Mr. George Katzman, please stand and be recognized. Actually, Mr. Katzman, please join us on stage. It is your right. I would like for a brief moment for all of you to sit back down so that the only two people standing are two brothers in arms, two individuals whose destinies connected them through united souls. The person to Mr. Katzman's right is Mr. Julius Eisenstein, the liberator and the liberated, standing together after decades of that eventful day when Mr. Katzman entered Dachau. My friends, graduates, this is living history. This is inspired and inspiring living. This is the best example of human decency. This is a clear picture of perseverance. This is by destiny and design, the work of God and men, all on the same stage. This is the image you are to live up to. I received a letter about these two gentlemen before you. I know that they interacted with this class back in 2009. A documentary was produced as a result of their incredible journey, a journey of the spirit. And one thing I have not shared with you is that Mr. Eisenstein was robbed of his youth. He was never able to finish high school. He was never able to wear a cap and a gown. He was never able to be hugged by his family upon receiving a high school diploma.
Good morning, and welcome to our Holocaust Awareness Assembly. The PowerPoint photos you are watching are photos that I took at Dachau. Today will be a day of learning about intolerance, hatred, injustice, pain, and suffering. But it will also be a day to learn about celebrating life. As you leave at the end of the program, it is my hope that you will realize how fortunate we all are to live here in this place at this time. There are those that teach and write books stating the Holocaust never happened, that it is a myth or a fable. Today we will present evidence and the testimony of eyewitnesses that were there, those that experienced that nightmare of history. You will meet people today that survived the atrocities of torture, starvation, enslavement, and deprivation. They lost their possessions, their homes, and their families to systematic murder that we call genocide. First, Julius Eisenstein. He was a prisoner in the Dachau concentration camp located near Munich, Germany. He will tell you his story. It is painful for him to do so, but he is here today as your mentor, your teacher, so that you can learn how intolerance and hatred can cause both physical and mental torture. Julius survived life in a concentration camp while millions of others perished. Our second hero is Professor George Katzman, a U.S. Army soldier in 1945 who was fighting the Nazi armies in Europe. He served with General George Patton's tank command. His unit discovered and liberated those imprisoned at Dachau and other camps. He will tell you his story and what he witnessed during the liberation that took place 64 years ago this week. Gentlemen, we welcome you both to our school. Thank you for coming. First, may we hear from our survivor, Julius Eisenstein.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Julius Eisenstein. I am thinking of today, May the 5th. On May the 5th, 64 years ago, May the 5th, I was reborn. I shouldn't be here, and I question myself, why am I here? I was liberated in Dachau on April the 29th, 1945. I'm going to go back to tell you my story about my family. I am one of five children. I had a father, a mother, I had three sisters, I had a little nephew. And I still am lucky because I have a brother, which is very unusual. Most families disappeared from this world. They have nobody. I still have a brother. The war in Poland broke out on September the 1st, 1939. Immediately, the Jews started to feel the brunt of the Germans. They were running, and wherever they found a Jew, they would just machine gun them. When they came to my town, my father, myself, and my brother ran away. We left my mother and my sisters back home because they were telling us wherever the Germans come into a town, the first thing they line up the Jewish men and they machine gun them. So we ran towards the outskirts of Warsaw, and then the Germans caught up with us. We came back home, and my mother was still there. We had a business. My father had a bakery business and a grocery store. And a few weeks later, a man came in with a piece of paper, told my father to get out of the business. We had to leave the business, and we lived on the outskirts of my hometown. They made us leave our apartment. We had to move into the ghetto. We were in the ghetto until about October of 1942, and then in November 1942, one morning at about 5 o'clock, we heard a lot of machine guns and a lot of yelling and loudspeakers and those German dogs, the big dogs, and we had to leave our apartments lined up in the street, 5 in a row. It was my father, my mother, my 2 sisters, and myself. My brother worked for the Germans, so he did not come home that night. He stayed there wherever he worked at. And we lined up, and they were marching us towards the soccer field of our high school in my hometown. And on the way to march at the soccer field, they had made an announcement. All boys 18 to 25 should step out of line. I didn't want to step out, obviously, because I didn't want to leave my father, my mother, and my sisters. But as I walked a little further, I was grabbed by the neck from a German assessment. I was pulled out of the line, and that was the last time that I have seen my parents and my sisters alive. They took me out, and they took another boys, about 20 of them, and we had to go to the apartments and pick up the dead bodies of the people the Germans shot, who did not go out of their houses. If they didn't go out and the Germans came in, whoever they found in the house, they shot. We had to take those people, put them on a truck, and bring them to the cemetery and bury them. From 14,000 Jews in my hometown, we remained about 800. The 800 were mostly laborers, like shoemakers, carpenters, tailors, tinsmiths, and so forth. We were there until about 1943, and in 43, they liquidated the remainder of us, the 800, and we came into the first working camp in Poland. We were there for about a year.
The photo you see is of a cattle car that was utilized to move people from the ghettos to the concentration camps. These prisoners being sent to the camps were civilians. They were civilian prisoners traveling without food, water, toilets, air conditioning, heating, or light. It must have been terrifying. There were no windows, so they were in total darkness going to the unknowable. There was no air conditioning for use in summer, nor any heating for use in winter. Germany's at the same latitude as Canada, so the weather extremes are both hot and freezing in winters. People died in those cattle cars in transit, and they were stacked up in a corner. In a day or so, the train stopped so they could throw the dead bodies out of the cars onto the side of the railroad tracks. The smell of human waste and dead, rotting flesh in those rail cars must have been overpowering. Elie Wiesel received the Nobel Peace Prize for a book he wrote called Night. It's about his experiences as a young boy, a teenager, being taken to a concentration camp with his father. Elie and his family were crammed into a closed cattle car with 80 other people, with no light, little to eat or drink, barely enough room to stand or to breathe. During the first night at Auschwitz-Birkenau, which was a slaughter factory, as he and his father waited in line to be thrown into a fire pit, he watched as a small wagon pulled up and delivered its load of children into the fire. The children were burned alive. This account is in his book, Night. And he thought he had gone mad. And he had to ask other people, did he really see what he thought he had just witnessed? These prisoners hanging from the trees are suffering from a form of crucifixion, a method of slow, torturous strangulation. Hanging in this position causes the diaphragm muscle to become exhausted as the victim tries to inhale and then expel air from the lungs. These photos are or were on display at the Dachau Museum, located 11 miles outside of Munich, Germany. These photos were put on public display by the modern-day German government. In the photo you're looking at, you see a prisoner being placed in a high-altitude chamber and photographed as he slowly dies from high-altitude sickness. This was one of the experiments that were done on prisoners that was photographed and put on display in the Dachau Museum. This building was used to force young Jewish women into sex slavery for the German soldiers. This is of significance as the Germans claimed that Jews were Untermenschen, that's less than human or being subhuman. Therefore, it was permissible to kill or exterminate them. If Jews were from a lower life form, such as animals, and not human, then forcing young women and girls into sex slavery must have meant the German soldiers were having sex with animals. This exposes their belief in Untermenschen to be a lie. When they were tired of raping these young girls and women, they sent them to their deaths in the gas chamber and took new prisoner arrivals to the prison camp for their replacement. These photos are of ovens that were used to burn the bodies. Here we see additional ovens that demonstrate the pulley system used to open and close the hot ovens. These ovens burned bodies 24/7. The smoke and smell of burning human flesh was carried for miles. Local German residents living near Dachau certainly knew what was happening. More and more prisoners kept arriving by train, well beyond the capacity of the camp to house them. Local bakers continually provided bread to feed the same number of prisoners. The ash and burned flesh smell belching out of the crematorium chimney was the only explanation of why the number of prisoners didn't continue to grow.
I want you to know I am a jack of all trades. I can be a carpenter, a shoemaker, an electrician, a bricklayer, a ditch digger, anything you want. We came to that first camp and we were there for about almost a year. And after that, the Russian army started to get closer and we were moved from that camp into Germany. I came with the rest of the people from that camp to Oranienburg in Germany. From Oranienburg, they shipped us to Sachsenhausen. From Sachsenhausen, they shipped us to Dachau. We came into Dachau and we started to work building underground airplane factories for the German Luftwaffe. We were there until about April of 1945. And towards the end of April 1945, one day they came in and they said, okay, everybody is going to be marching out. We're going to liquidate this camp. And we're going towards the Tyrolean mountains. And we went there, my brother and myself. with the whole group. We went there, and when we came into Auschwitz, they said, anybody who is able and willing should line up, and we're going to walk towards the Tyrolean Mountains. Whoever cannot walk stays here. My brother and I decided to stay there because we were just finished. If the war would have taken one more day, I would not be here to talk to you. The next morning, about 7 o'clock in the morning, we have seen the first Jeep crashing through the main gate to the camp, and we were liberated by the American army. We were liberated, and I remained in Munich. I remained in Germany until about 1950. 1950, I came to the United States. I married in 1947. My wife is also a Holocaust survivor, and we married in 1947. My daughter was born in 1948, and we came to the United States in 1950. I can't begin to tell you how lucky you are, the next generation, that you live in a country like the United States. You cannot imagine how thankful you should be. And I have one aim, I have one message for you, that you should not be bystanders. You should speak up if you see something done to the next guy or the next lady, whether she is white or black or green or blue or any other thing, you should speak up. I would not like to have that happen again, what happened to us, and it's up to you to do this. I came to the United States in 1950. I am talking to you because it is my duty to tell you that you are the last generation who is listening to a live Holocaust survivor. Another few years from now, there will be nobody around. You're going to read a book, and you know what you get in a book. You read it, and you close it up, and the next thing you do is something else. So I am pleading with you, please, please, be nice to each other, and don't let that happen again to anybody. This is a picture taken by one of the men in the death camp in Treblinka. This, you see that stone with a name on it. This is my hometown. And whatever's left in Treblinka, you don't see any personal stones or monuments. You see only stones with cities, towns, and villages which were wiped off the map of this world, and whatever's left is only one stone with a name on it. This is the first time after 50-some years that myself, my brother, and my wife, and my sister-in-law went to Treblinka, and I could say a Kaddish for my parents, because I know this is the place where they perished. This is a picture of the liberation of Dachau. I am in that picture there. That is the picture of the death march, that we marched from my camp towards the main camp of Dachau. That's another picture of the day of the liberation in Dachau. And you've seen on the top an American flag. And I wonder up until today where that flag came from, a day after we were liberated. This is a picture of myself at the day of the liberation. If you look any closer to it, you will see I have no teeth. My teeth were knocked out by the assessment, by two assessmen, by not saluting to them when I suppose I had orders to do it, and I didn't. I did it, and they knocked out my teeth. This is a picture that I just got a little while ago. This is a very, very terrible picture for me to explain to you. You see a German in the middle, and I read it in German because I got it sent from Germany, from the Bürgermeister of Landsberg. He sent me that picture, and he in the picture he explained to me that the day that the Americans came in And the Americans had seen the atrocities, what the Germans did in the camp close to them. They came to the homes of the Germans, they took out men, and they brought them into the camps, and they made them pick up those dead bodies. That's another one of those pictures where they pick up those dead bodies, if you notice, and they put them on the little wagon to bring them to the place where they're going to be buried. This is the picture of the last camp that I was in, and that was at the 50th anniversary in Germany, and we were cramped in those barracks. There about 150 people. There was no floor. The floor was mud. We walked into that place, we walked into mud. And this is the picture that was done about 20 years ago. This was myself about a half a year later, and I have already some hair on my head. I had no hair, our hair was cut off. This is the synagogue in our hometown where before they sent out the people to Treblinka, they brought in some people from the little villages to this synagogue. They crammed them into the synagogue, they locked the doors, they threw in a few cans of gasoline, and they burned the synagogue with the people inside. Pictures are more than 1,000 words. This is a picture I got by coincidence from a friend of my father's who came to the United States in 1905. And when I came to the States in 1950, I met this gentleman the first time. He told me he's got a picture that I will never forget. That's my father when he was maybe about 15 years old, my three aunts, and one of my uncles. None of them is alive. They all perished. They all had families and children. And none of them is alive. This was my mother. And again, 99% of Holocaust survivors have no pictures of their families because they were taken away from them. This picture is of my mother. She was at that time 48 years old, and that picture was taken for the German identification cards. That is my oldest sister. She was married. She had a boy of 2 years, and she had a choice to give up the boy and stay alive or go with the boy. Obviously, she went with the boy and she is not alive anymore. That is my younger sister. She was not married. She was about 22. And this picture is my younger sister, the second from the left. Now we're going to get to Auschwitz. This lady is the heroine of Auschwitz. She had smuggled some dynamite from the factory she worked in. She worked in a dynamite factory. And any of you who read books about the Holocaust knows that in 1944 in Auschwitz-Birkenau, the inmates of the camp were blown up two of the crematoriums in the camp. And she was the one who was smuggling the dynamite from her place that she worked. And through thanks to her, two of those crematoriums were blown up. This is the railroad track in Auschwitz. This is the railroad track they brought in. Every 2 hours, they brought in a new transport of people, and they chased them like a herd of cattle into the gas chambers. I worked outside of the crematorium. I could see that every few hours, the new transports coming in, and the people screaming and crying and yelling. This is the entrance to Auschwitz. There is a staircase. This is when they brought the people from the railroad tracks. They chased them around that corner, made them go down the stairs. And this was the holding bin before they pushed them into the gas chambers. That's the time when they told them to undress, and that's when the most of the screams and the yellings and the crying came, because the people finally realized that this is their last hour of their life. This is my wife here in the front, and she's explaining the women's barracks in Auschwitz, Birkenau. That's where we were. And the woman who was in charge of that barrack was every morning running around in the middle with a big whip. And if you didn't get out within 5 minutes to the outside to line up, She whipped the people like cattle. This is another camp, Majdanek. If you ever go to visit Europe and you go to the concentration camps, I would suggest very highly that you go to Majdanek. Majdanek is the only camp which was not demolished. It is today just the way it was before. The Russians have liberated that camp, and the Germans didn't have a chance to demolish it before the Russians came in. This is today, if you go there, you will see that's a heap of ashes and bones of the people which were cremated in Majdanek. This is the crematorium in Majdanek, where they burned the bodies after they were gassed. This is a table next to crematorium, where they took the dead bodies and they ripped out their golden teeth from their mouth, and then they put them into the crematorium. This is, like I said to you before, I am lighting a candle here and I'm saying that prayer for my parents, because I know this is where they perished. Whoever's going to read books about the Holocaust is going to come across a book about a Pole who had an orphanage of Jewish children. His name was Janusz Korczak. And he had the choice when they took those kids to have them guessed. They told him, because he was not Jewish, that he doesn't have to go there, he can be saved. And he decided to go with the children. So in Treblinka, you have one monument with a name of a person, and that is Janusz Korczak. The only monument I have after my parents and my family is in Miami, at the museum, where I had put the names of my parents and my sisters. And every year, when that day comes, when they perish, when they were sent away, I go there. That's the only monument, the only place I have to go there to identify that that is where they perished.
Can you imagine what it would be like not having grandparents, not having aunts and uncles, not having cousins, not having parents? It's a foreign concept to most of us to have no family. In many cases, the people who went through the concentration camps came out and had no one. They had nowhere to return. Their homes were gone. They had no jobs. They had no possessions. They had nothing. They had to start their life anew from that point forward. These are very difficult things to try to understand. We are very fortunate to live in this place at this time. We have so much. Next, I'd like to hear from our liberator, Professor George Katzman, an author, a scholar, a teacher for over 25 years. George served with General Patton's Third Army and was instrumental in liberating Dachau and other concentration camps.
This is one lecture I don't like to do. As a matter of fact, I didn't talk about the concentration camps with my family for at least 35 years after the war. And I never showed them my pictures. My life, France, Germany, Czechoslovakia. But the human mind is wonderful. We like to block out the bad things. Until one day, some years ago, I read an article that a professor at Northwestern University said that this whole story of the Holocaust was a lie. It never happened. I was enraged. He was calling people like Julius and me liars, and my buddies. And he wasn't even born then. So for the first time I started to speak out. I don't like talking about it, but we have to. Because unfortunately, hatred is still with us. You're not born with it, it's an acquired skill. So let me get back to ancient history, over 60 years ago. I went into the Army in 1943. I'd been working in a war plant in Waterbury, Connecticut, and I decided enough was enough. I had a guilty conscience that other people were in the Army and serving the country, and I wasn't. You have to remember that in 1940, the population of America was 140 million people. In 1943, 17 million of us were in service in uniform. One out of every eight Americans. So I told my foreman at the plant to stop sending in automatic deferments and let me go into the Army. I was assigned to the 16th Tank Battalion, trained in Camp Chaffee, Arkansas, and went overseas with my unit. On the way over, we were picked up by German submarines, and we were chased for 2 days, and I have to tell you, that's a very unpleasant experience, to be zigzagging on a ship, in the hold of the ship, with 500 American soldiers, only one little ladder going up to the deck, and hearing the depth charges that the destroyers were lowering to try and get the submarines. I landed in Normandy after the invasion. Otherwise, if I'd landed during the invasion, I wouldn't be here, because I was a rifleman, a lowly scout rifleman. We heard rumors about death camps and prisons and so forth. Nonsense. Every military force in the world in a war uses propaganda. The Germans had a fellow called Joseph Goebbels, and we had our own propaganda. We have it right now. Remember phrases like weapons of mass destruction? When we didn't find any Iraq, then we were there because of regime change. There's a guy in the White House who does nothing but come up with these phrases. So in my war, it was this ridiculous rumor that the Germans were killing civilians. Nonsense. I have to tell you that as we fought across France, we captured a few Germans, excellent soldiers, certainly much better equipped than we were. Their tanks we could not knock out. We had to call in fighter bombers to knock out their tanks. Our artillery couldn't do it. Their weapons, their machine guns, submachine guns, fired twice the rate of ours. I had one day in combat, I drove straight into a crossfire of German machine guns. It was a hail of bullets all around me. Didn't get scratched. I asked the good Lord why, and he told me so I could be here today to tell you kids about it, to annoy you, to annoy my wife. Bottom line is that we did not believe, and we were sure of it, that the Germans were not torturing and killing civilians. The first camp we liberated, the other side of the Rhine River, had 600 Russian officers in there. Yeah, their clothes were a little bit tattered and they looked a little bit dirty, but they were reasonably well fed. Obviously, this is propaganda. We captured Nuremberg, an old world city. I remember Gestapo headquarters, where we found dum-dum bullets and wooden bullets. Now, why am I telling you about these bullets? Well, first of all, they're illegal. Every country in the world has signed agreements not to use these things. A dum-dum bullet is a regular bullet where you cut a cross in the lead part. Why? So when it hits your body, it expands. Instead of coming out this big, it takes out your body. Interesting, nice? Sure. We also found wooden bullets. When they go into your body, they splinter. You bleed to death internally. This was the point where we found out that we were fighting not skilled soldiers, but animals.
atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima, Japan. A military target killed approximately 100,000 people, to equal the number of deaths to civilians in Nazi concentration camps through murder and starvation. It would take 120 atomic bombs.
We still weren't mad until we got to a place called Langwasserlager. Langwasserlager, long water camp. And my platoon at that time, which were originally, we were 20, was down now to 14 men. And we had heard rumors that there was a camp nearby. So we drove down, my platoon, two jeeps in front, a half track with a machine gun on it, and two jeeps in back. I was driving the second jeep. We come down this dirt road in the woods, and at the end of the road we could see what looked like a barricade. So we did what we were trained to do. We stopped our vehicles, we got out, went into the ditches on either side, weapons drawn, and we advanced on this, what turned out to be a fence. As we got closer, we could hear murmurs coming from behind the fence. Couldn't see anything. Got louder and louder. My buddy, Mike Gazzini, had a submachine gun, and he shot the lock off the fence, and we opened the gates to hell. 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 We opened the gates to walking skeletons who nobody weighed more than 60 or 70 pounds, and we're talking about grown men. Walking skeletons. And we stood there shocked. We were young kids. I was one of the oldest ones. I was 24. And we looked at them. And they started to smile. American uniforms. They were free. And they come staggering out while we stood there. And they'd walk over to me. The reason I'm wearing this is because this is the sleeve that they touched. In my right hand, I had my M1 rifle. They touched the sleeve, smiled, and then keeled over and died. And they kept on dying. And these were civilians. I had seen mountains of dead American soldiers and mountains of dead German soldiers, but these were civilians. And I have to tell you, the stench was incredible. And every once in a while I'd walk through the camp, and one time I walked through there and they had a little bonfire going, these walking skeletons in rags, and somebody was singing. What? So I walked over. I'm fortunate, I speak a lot of languages. And in German I said, why are you singing? Look at you. What have you got to sing about? He said he heard a rumor that his daughter, who was in a different camp, was alive. And he was joyous. This was one happy little man. Well, needless to say, we had to pack up and move on out. And the war ended. I was deep in Czechoslovakia, had to contact the Russians. I'm not going to talk too long about this, but I have to read this to you. This is a translation of a German profit and loss statement. For those of you who study business, you can learn about profit and loss statements. It's an accounting of money. And the Germans were extremely efficient. So the following table was discovered in a concentration camp where the SS, now let me tell you what the SS were. These were the Schutzstaffel. These were the black shirts, 160,000 of them, who never swore allegiance to Germany. They swore allegiance to Adolf Hitler, his personal army, and they were the ones in charge of the death camps. They would rent out slave laborers to the Germans, to the industrialists. You drive a Mercedes-Benz, they were one of them. They were fed infrequently, provided with squalid living conditions, no medical attention, and forced to work until they died. And here is the table of profits per citizen in an SS-operated concentration camp. Income from rental of prisoner to the industrialist per day, 6 Reichmarks. A Reichmark is a quarter, so it's a buck and a half. But you had to deduct for the cost of the meals that you had to feed them. That came out to 60 pfennigs. 100 pfennigs make a Reichmark. You do the math. Life expectancy, it's right here. 9 months equals 270 days times 5.3 Reichmarks. They already deducted the food. So you get a total of 1,431 Reichmarks. Not a bad profit. But you had to take off 10 pfennigs for the amortization of the clothing, the rags that they wore. So the profit from the costs has to be added. These are highly intelligent, highly industrialized German people. The gold teeth, you had knocked them out. I've seen a bag of gold teeth. The clothing, articles of value, money, minus the cost of cremation. It costs you 2 Reichmarks to create a corpse. Cremate a corpse. So the average net profit was 200 Reichmarks. 50 bucks. But that did not include the profit from the sale of the bones and the ashes. Now, how low can you get when you actually document something like this? The reason I'm here is because I could not tolerate sitting by, being an eyewitness to this, and having some idiot professor at Northwestern University say that I'm a liar, and so is Julius. I saw it. I can talk to you about it. I can read from the sheet. I can't tell you about the smell. That's going to stay with me for the rest of my life. Man's inhumanity to man. So if you hear somebody tell a joke which has an ethnic background, that somebody is black or white or pink or Jewish or Catholic or Protestant or Muslim, don't go there. Because what we're talking about is the result of race and religious hatred, something that you are not born with, that you have to learn about. And unfortunately, the German people learned about it. We got our revenge. We made them carry the coffins of the 200 dead soldiers, dead civilians, slave laborers that the Germans shot at Nuremberg. Oh, that's me. I'm carrying a German Mauser rifle, which I captured, and under my arm is a Walter PPK, that's James Bond's gun. Mine is sitting now in the Holocaust Museum in Hollywood. There he is. He's in Nuremberg. I was in that same square. It's a gorgeous 14th century church. Still there. This is a typical Nazi, these are, by the way, are Nazi propaganda pictures that I took out of a house in Nuremberg. Notice the pomp and circumstance. There's Adolf Hitler, Joseph Goebbels, and on the right is Hermann Göring. I was at Nuremberg during the Nazi war crimes trials and actually saw him. And they asked him, how do you plead? And he said, ich bediene mich unschuldig. I was only following orders. I am not guilty. Only following orders? That war that he was one of those responsible for killed 51 million people. And he was only following orders. There's Adolf, walking with his pomp and circumstance. I have to tell you about their weapons. You're looking at what we call German 88s. This was the most incredible cannon in the world. It not only could knock out a tank, and one of the first things I saw in combat was one of our Sherman tanks with one of those cannon shots right through the three-inch turret on each side, went right through both sides. Our weapons were no match. At the end of the war, we finally got a 90 millimeter, which would match up. The war was over. These are the black shirts, the SS troopers. He convinced a nation of intelligent people that they were pure Aryans, and that everybody else was Untermenschen, lower people. And they loved the idea. And right here in America today, we have skinhead groups that call themselves white Aryan power. Does anybody here know what an Aryan looks like? Persians, Iranians, that's what they look like. Nothing like you and me, nothing. But that's the power of the big lie technique. You say something loud enough and long enough, and people listen to you. They believe you. And he was a master at it. That's them, the black shirts. You see the SS design on the collar? Dreaded. The day before we captured Nuremberg, I told you they took 200 Jewish slave laborers out into the forest and killed them. There's a picture of that kid looking at the dead body of his father. We had the German civilians come out, put them in coffins. There are the coffins in front of their city hall, and we made everyone walk by and take a look at these skeletons, rags. And again, you can't smell what they smelled. See the kid standing in front? That's a 17-year-old Jewish slave laborer. And he's looking at the body, the dead body of his father. You can't see too well, but half of them have their faces smashed in. There they go, civilians carrying the coffins. Notice the striped jacket. That's the concentration camp uniform. All spread out. How could you not know? They employed them. Anybody know who this is? My boss, General George Patton. And this is what wonderful downtown Nuremberg looked like, the old walled city, in 1945. There wasn't one building that was not damaged. Thank you very much.
Allied bombers occasionally attacked Nazi factories near the Auschwitz III camp. Bombers could have destroyed key railway junctions leading to the camps and to gas chambers at some of those camps. Bombing Auschwitz would have stopped some of the mass murders. Allied leaders refused to divert any bombers the few miles from targets at the rubber factory to stop the mass slaughter at Auschwitz. In August 1944, 430,000 Hungarian Jewish civilians were sent by trains to Auschwitz. Most were gassed to death upon arrival. Oskar Schindler, a German industrialist, saved 1,200 enslaved Jewish civilian factory workers from almost certain death. He had those workers designated as essential workers by bribing Nazi officials. This story has been told in the movie Schindler's List. Lesser known is Irene Sandler. She was a young woman from Warsaw, Poland, and managed to save 2,500 small children by smuggling them out of the Warsaw ghetto. She was nominated for Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. In 1937, a young teacher from Texas ran for Congress, and he was elected. He had compassion for those denied human rights and dignity. He helped arrange for forged travel documents to help smuggle hundreds of European Jews fleeing Nazi terrorism. These fleeing refugees were brought into the United States through the port in Houston, Texas. Later in his career, this righteous Gentile, as President of the United States, signed the 1964 Civil Rights Law to help Americans of African heritage obtain full citizenship rights. Standing directly behind President Lyndon Baines Johnson is the Reverend Martin Luther King, Jr. George, thank you for sharing that and being a witness to what you had seen and sharing with us the photographic evidence and proof of what took place. We have some additional special guests that I'd like to introduce to you. How many of you have attended the Student Awareness Day program while a student here at MLEC? Raise a hand. How many students here have had a chance to go? I'd like to introduce to you the persons responsible for organizing and producing that program that we attend every year. Mrs. Rosita Konigsberg, the Executive Vice President of the Holocaust Documentation and Education Center. Would you stand? Ms. Merrill Saferstein, the Director of Educational Outreach at the Holocaust Documentation Education Center. She has been kind enough to have invited me to bring students to their programs for almost 20 years. I appreciate what they have done for our students all of these years, and I thank you for that. Next, I'd like to introduce a child of survivors. Both of her parents endured 4 years in various slave labor camps in Poland. If you're in my class, you have read her mother's story of survival. The daughter of survivors, Mrs. Betty Eichelbaum, my wife. We have today with us also Mr. Mort Gilbert, a child of a survivor, who has a document about Dachau that he would like to share with us. Mr. Gilbert.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Morton Gilbert, and my mother and father were both born in Poland, and they were both taken to concentration camps. My mother was in her 20s at the time and married and had a one-year-old baby boy. And when she was taken to the ghetto in Lodz, Poland, her baby boy was taken away from him and she never saw the baby again. And she worked in the ghetto for many years and was then taken to Auschwitz and subsequently to the Dachau concentration camp. My father was in several camps also and ended up in Dachau. And both my parents lost their parents, and as a result, I never knew a grandparent ever in my life. And all of my aunts and uncles perished as well, and so I really never knew their family. I have had the honor myself of serving in the United States Army, and there's a special reason that I have joined you here today. And I was fortunate to discover a photo of the liberation of Dachau a number of years ago. And I'd like to have that photo put up on the screen if you have that handy. That's the photo there. And when I discovered, when I saw that photo, I thought I better take a close look at it, because it is the liberation of Dachau, and I my mother and father were both in that camp, so I took a magnifying glass and I was looking very carefully at the photo, and I'm going to walk up to the photo for a moment.
I was fortunate enough to discover by looking at this photo that my father is in the photo right here next to my finger.
Only a few people down. Let's see. Julius here. Can you move the photo a little bit in this direction and straighten out? Here, I'll point him out because I already know Julius' face with his big smile. Julius and I already feel like we're related. Julius will always be very close to my heart for the rest of my life. And the main reason that I wanted to come here today was this is my first chance in my life to be able to say thank you to somebody who participated in liberating my parents. So I'm going to take this moment right now to come over here to Professor George Katzman, give him a big hug and a kiss, and thank you for liberating my family. Thank you so much, George. Because of you and your fellow soldiers, my parents were liberated, and I have a beautiful wife, Kitty, who joined me in the audience today. She's sitting over there. Thank you so much, George. Thank you very much, everybody.
We have some time for some questions from the audience. If we're going to bring up the house lights, please. If students have a question of either our survivor or the liberator.
You're Jewish. How did your faith change throughout the whole time you were in the camp?
Well, I have a big problem with religion. I am Jewish. I was born Jewish. I do believe that there is something in this universe which takes care of us. I personally, when I came to Auschwitz, and when they chased us from the train into the showers, I looked up in the sky. I have seen four big chimneys spitting out the fire and the smell of the dead bodies. And I said to myself, it is impossible that something like this can happen, and where is God? Well, I do believe God is here, but God is in, I don't believe in one in different gods. I think there's only one God. And the God is in your heart. You got to be a nice person. And again, I can't stress enough to you, please don't stand by when you see something done to some of your friends which you don't like. Speak up.
Thank you, Julius. I'd now like to introduce to you one of our faculty members, Chef Mark Moyle from Culinary Arts. He also has a connection to the Holocaust. Chef?
Well, good morning, everyone. The reason I came by this morning to speak to everyone is, yes, the Holocaust affected me as well. 90% of my family were wiped out in the Holocaust in various different concentration camps, from Bergen-Belsen, Treblinka, Dachau, and I was looking at the photos, and they're kind of hard to watch. And but I think the most important message I want to leave with everyone today is that there's still a lot of bad things going on in this world because of racial indifference, ethnic indifferences between people, whether it's in Darfur and a lot of other places in the United States. And yeah, these gentlemen, and I do say gentlemen, how you could, someone could live through an experience like that and be able to talk to it, my hat's off to you, gentlemen. I would never be able to do it. But it is your responsibility, guys, because now when you're getting out of school, that when things like this do happen, someone has to say something. Someone's got to do something. Because this, even though it happened and finished in 1945, can easily happen again today. So it's up to you, each and every one of you, that you got to make, be proactive and not let this happen and this and stop all this inhumanity to man. So on behalf, I'd like to just to thank, on behalf of the culinary staff, both of these gentlemen, I probably wouldn't be here. I saw some of the photos. Some of my family could have been in those photos. So if it weren't for these gentlemen liberating the camps, I may not be here myself today. So on behalf of the school, I'd just like to say thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Chef. Many people think this was ancient history. It isn't. This is just a generation ago. Today we have met heroes of the World War II era. You've heard their eyewitness testimony. You've seen evidence of what happened in Europe in the 1930s and 1940s. It is my hope that sometime in the future, should you hear someone say the Holocaust didn't happen, the first word out of your mouth will be, stop. Let me give you evidence that it did happen. Let me tell you of people I've met, things I've heard, and what I've seen. Elie Wiesel, the author of Night, wrote, take sides. Neutrality helps the oppressor, never the victim. Silence encourages a tormentor, never the tormented. By attending today's program, it is my hope that you've learned that education and remembrance are the only cures for hatred and bigotry. Chef Mark has prepared something special for our guests today. We have a birthday cake for them. Thank you to our guests for having come here today to share their experiences with us. Thank you to our technical staff and their students for all they did to make this program possible. Thank you to the teachers for attending, and thank you, all the students that made the choice to attend.
Today, may I call you Julius? Today, Julius is going to get his diploma. And I do think that it is befitting for him to receive his diploma not lined up, for he shall not walk another line again, but in full witness of all of the graduates, a grateful and compassionate community, and the dais right up here. We will all stand as witnesses to the winning spirit. This is inspired and inspiring living. This is by destiny and design, the work of God and men. This is the image you are to live up to.